This is a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Please join with me as we call ourselves to worship on this morning. The steadfast love of our Lord never ceases.
Mercies never come to an end.
The love of the Lord is new every morning. Let us now join together in singing our opening hymn this morning, hymn number 276, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Please stand if you are able to do so. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us turn to God in prayer. O Lord of compassion and hope, we thank you that your Holy Spirit was sent to the world to encourage those whom Jesus left behind that they might never be alone. Through the comfort of your presence, you have empowered those apostles to bear witness to your enduring love that stands the test of time. And today we also seek the encouragement of your presence, that you might share with us your Holy Spirit, that we might not be alone, that we might have communion with you. Spark a fire within us all, that we might be molded to the image of who we should be, Christ's holy name. That Savior who taught us all as disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before you're seated, take just a moment to exchange words of greeting with those seated around you today.
Welcome to Buford Presbyterian Church. We are so glad to have all of you here with us this morning. And on this day, we extend a special welcome to those that are visiting with us this morning. We do hope that you will find that God's Spirit is present here with you as you worship today here with us. On your pews, you will find your ritual of friendship pads. And if you have not already, we invite you to sign those and pass those down your rows, so that we might know that you're here today. And if you're sitting on a row with somebody that you don't know, it gives you an opportunity to get to know their name as well. In your bulletins, you're going to find a number of announcements about the activities that are taking place in the life of our congregation. And I invite you at some point today to read through all of those when you get a chance. There are a number of those that I'm going to call attention to you now. If you have been by our office this week, then you have probably had the opportunity to meet Nikki Faco. Nikki is our new office administrator. And if you haven't had a chance to swing by the office, we do invite you to come and say hello and to welcome her. She started with us earlier this week, and we are grateful and excited for her work and ministry among us. You will see in your bulletin, Nikki will be responsible for sort of the front of the office kinds of things, our bulletin, the announcements, scheduling of the building, those kinds of things. If you need her when you need her, you'll see in your bulletin that her email address is in there, Nikki@BufordPres.com. Chris Latana, who Tim last week mentioned, has moved to Florida, will continue as our finance administrator. She'll continue to work for us remotely. And her email address is also in your bulletin. The one that she will be using is finance@BufordPres.com. Her email address with Chris@BufordPres will be going away. So we want to make sure that you're aware of those changes. But you'll see all of that on the back of your bulletin with all of our email information. We want to make sure that everybody is aware that our stewardship campaign is fast approaching, and we will kick off that stewardship campaign next Sunday. So we do invite you to be here with us. We'll be exploring throughout our stewardship season this year, our theme, Upon This Rock. And so you'll be hearing from Pastor Corey and I, as well as others, about what that means for the life and ministry of our congregation, and we're very excited to be sharing that with you. A few things that we will be doing a little bit differently this year. In years past, we have had a stewardship luncheon to sort of conclude our stewardship campaign each year, and this year we're going to do that as we kick things off. So we will celebrate next week with our stewardship luncheon. It'll be a potluck luncheon following this worship service, our 11 o'clock worship service. We invite you to come and to join with us. So if you are able, we invite you to sign up on the sheet in the narthex, bring a dish for 10 to 12 folks, and come and join us during that lunch. You'll have an opportunity to hear from our finance committee and some others about our theme, about our stewardship goals, and there's a lot of information that we'd like to share with you. So we invite you to come and to be a part of that lunch next Sunday. Don't want you to forget about our Arts and Crafts Fair. It'll be our third annual Arts and Crafts Fair on Saturday, October the 15th from 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock in our gym. And so we invite you to come and perhaps get a little bit of early Christmas shopping done, but it promises to be a fun and a great event, and we hope that you will come and join us for that. You'll see within our bulletins that all of our groups, our men's prayer breakfast, our Presbyterian women's groups are beginning to meet again for the month of October, and you'll find all of those meeting dates in your bulletin, folks to contact if you need more information about those groups. Today is the first Sunday of the month, and so as we do each first Sunday, we'll be collecting our PATH offering in a few minutes during our worship service. PATH stands for Presbyterian Answer to Hunger. 75% of that offering will stay right here in our community and will go to North Gwinnett Co-op. 10% of that will go to our presbytery to address hunger-related issues. And so we'll be collecting that offering following our children's sermon in just a few moments. And my final announcement for the morning is to say a few words about some of the music that will be taking place during our worship service this morning. During communion, our youth will be singing for us a part of our communion music. And then following the song that they'll be singing for us this morning, we will all join in singing Jesus Remember Me. And you'll see that printed in your bulletin. The hymn number is 599, but we wanted to make sure that you were aware that that is to invite you all to sing with us as we conclude our time of communion this morning. Also, following our benediction response this morning, our youth will be leading us in a round. You'll see there at the end of the bulletin our congregational response there, and we'll begin by singing that together, and then we'll sing it in a round as we have done on a number of occasions in the past. Those are the announcements that I have. Are there any others that folks have this morning? Let us continue to worship God.
If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. Truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Knowing this, let us now turn to God, confessing our sins first together in a unison prayer and then in a moment of silence. Please join with me. Sovereign God, we confess that we have not turned away from sin. We worry that our hope is lost and forget the promise of your love. We take the gift of faith for granted and fail to keep your commandments. Forgive us, God of grace. Help us by your Holy Spirit to hold fast to the teaching of your word and guard the treasure entrusted to us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. God's hand is open to give us all of the good things that we need. God's faithful mercy is sure, because in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen. Be seated. At this time, I would like to call forward the children of the church for this morning's children's sermon. Hi. Good to see everybody. Hi there. Hi, come on down. Good to see everybody this morning. I hope you're all doing really well. Is everybody doing okay? Nobody's sick or anything. Good, good. I had something I wanted to show you today. Come on up. All right, there you go. Oh. This is something that someone gave me, a friend of mine who came from a country called South Korea gave me this, and it's like kind of almost like something you might hang up on your wall. I guess it is something you'd hang up on your wall, but I kind of keep it rolled up because I like it like that. And it's something that, can anybody tell me what that says?
A map.
A map? No, it's not a map. It's kind of like, it is a scroll, isn't it? But can you tell me what it says? I can't tell you what it says either because I don't know how to read Korean. This is in another language, but I had to ask somebody what it says and what they told me, and I hope that they told me right, and I think they did. It says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, which is a Bible verse right out of the book of Philippians. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's a wonderful verse. A lot of people like that Bible verse, and that was written, you guys can't see it, but it's written in Korean. And that made me think a lot about something that's really important to think about, and that is that there are people who believe in Jesus, who love God all over the world. And a lot of them speak languages that I don't know how to speak. And they write in languages that I don't know how to read. And this is another language. But there are people in South Korea who believe in Jesus and love God just like we do. And in fact, there are people in lots of other countries all around the world who believe in Jesus and maybe who speak other languages who we don't even know. We don't even know who they are. But they love God and they believe in Jesus like we do. This is a special Sunday in the year we call World Communion Sunday. And what happens on that day is that churches all over the world are encouraged, if they're not planning to do it already, to have communion that day. And in that way, when we take communion, we remember that there are people who believe in God and who love God right here, but there are people who believe in God in lots of other places, a long ways away. Places, maybe even countries that we'll never go to. I've never even been to South Korea. And yet, I know that there are people who love God in South Korea. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, in Korean. But we can say it in English, right? It's World Communion Sunday. Know that there are people who love God all over this world, not just in Buford, not just in Gwinnett County, in Georgia, where we live, not just in the United States, but in lots of other countries too, that Jesus loves people all over this world. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he came not only for us, but for people all over this world. Lord, help us to be of service. Help us to be faithful. And help us to love you more and more every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming. Will you hold the path basket? Will you hold it for me? You can just hold it by the two. You need to, Allie, you need to stand right down. Stand right there. Yeah, perfect. The psalmist tells us that the earth is the Lord's, and all that is in it, the world, and those who live in it. This sort of word from God to us reminds us of the fact that all that we have and all that we are is held in a kind of trust from God, that we have been provided with many things of body and of spirit for which we are thankful. And in ways of showing our thankfulness, let us now render unto God our tithes and offerings.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you create more than we could ever hope to return. You share more than we could ever hope to deserve. And yet we pray that you might accept these, our humble gifts. May they honor and glorify you in all of creation. And may they empower us for the work of witness and service, for the sake of justice and for the sake of peace in your world. Now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, verses 5 through 10. I invite you now to listen for God speaking to us this morning. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Come here at once and take your place at the table'? Would you not rather say to him, 'Prepare supper for me, put on your apron and serve me while I drink and eat. Later, you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, 'We are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.'" Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Increase our faith, the apostles said to the Lord. In these words, we hear the impassioned cry and perhaps even desperate plea from the disciples that opens our passage this morning. And let's be honest, who among us doesn't resonate with this request of the disciples? Who among us doesn't want more faith? Who doesn't feel as though they need more faith? It certainly seems to be a reasonable request that they are making. But I want for us to back up just a little bit. As is the case every week when Pastor Corey or I read scripture from the pulpit, we are reading to you only a part of the story. And while sometimes the stories that are taken from within the words of scripture can and indeed do stand on their own, more often than not, we can better or more fully understand their meaning when we better understand their context. And I think that is particularly true of these six verses. They are better understood if we understand more of what has been taking place in the Gospel of Luke and on this journey of Jesus and his disciples. Over the past few chapters, Jesus has been pushing the disciples pretty hard. And for good reason. At the end of chapter 9, Luke tells us Jesus turns and sets his face to go to Jerusalem. Jesus at this point is resolute. He knows and understands now where it is that his journey is leading. And as one preacher puts it, he has been taking his time, but he is also now moving quite intentionally into the hands of those who would kill him. And so his teaching and his preparation of the disciples for what is to come begins to ramp up. Jesus appoints and commissions 70 disciples, setting before them a model of ministry, and sends them out to proclaim the kingdom of God. He spars with a lawyer who wants to know who exactly his neighbor really is. He teaches his disciples to pray. He has some difficult words for the Pharisees and the scribes, for the rich, for those who have power. And then he tells them not to be anxious or not to worry, which I don't imagine at that point was particularly helpful. He emphasizes that the cost of discipleship and the reality of following him will have a high price to pay. "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father or mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even life itself, cannot be my disciple, he says. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Making this calling, if it didn't already seem so, seem even more impossible. Chapter 16, the one just before where we're reading this morning, contains two parables that both begin, "There was a rich man." We cannot serve God and wealth, Jesus says. And for those who are wealthy, a great chasm has been fixed, separating those who have in this life and those who have not. In the kingdom to come, the roles will be reversed, tables turned upside down. And then, still not quite done, Jesus assures the disciples in the verses just prior to ours this morning that things will get even more difficult. Occasions for stumbling are bound to come, he says, and it would be better for you if a huge stone hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea than for you to stumble or to cause someone else to stumble. No pressure. He goes on, though. If someone sins, no matter what they do, 7 times a day, you must turn back to them. You must forgive them, Jesus says. It is no wonder that the disciples cry out in the opening verse of our passage. It is no wonder that they plead and ask for their faith to be increased. They get it. They do seem to understand the cost of this calling. This kind of discipleship is demanding, painful even, causes us to feel insecure and inadequate when we consider what we're being asked to do. But wanting to rise to the challenge, wanting to please God, to make Jesus proud, they make an understandable request. Help us. Give us the faith to do better, to be better. You tell us to be aware, to be on guard. You tell us that we are to love, to have compassion, to forgive, to serve only you. And we want to do that. We want to follow you. We want to do as you command, but we need your help, Jesus. It is a request we resonate with because we understand how the demands of faith and the demands placed on us by the world seem to constantly be in such stark contrast with one another. It is a reality as true then as it is now, seemingly impossible to reconcile without at least a little help, without more faith. Increase our faith, they cry out. But in the face of such challenges, I wonder, what if the disciples are asking the wrong question? What if we are asking the wrong question? Increase our faith, they ask. Give us more. But how much more? How much faith is enough? What will more faith really do for us? Jesus's response in this passage feels a bit harsh, and honestly, scholars are divided on exactly how best to interpret these words of Jesus. On one hand, some would say if we hear these words as harsh, it is because they are intended to be so. If only you had faith the size of a mustard seed. If you had even a speck of faith, which you do not, is one way that we can hear and interpret these words of Jesus. On the other hand, other scholars, including the likes of Fred Craddock, suggest that we should hear Jesus' words more along these lines. If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, and you do, you could say to this mulberry tree. In other words, Jesus is not quite chastising the disciples for their lack of faith, but saying that even a tiny bit of authentic faith, which they already have, is more powerful than they could possibly imagine. If this is the case, Fred Craddock offers, Jesus' response then is not a reprimand for an absence of faith, but an affirmation of the faith that they have and an invitation to live out the full possibilities of that faith. Even the small faith they already have cancels out words such as impossible, like a tree being uprooting itself, words like absurd, the idea of planting a tree in the sea, and puts those words in touch with the power of God. To ask, increase our faith, calls into question whether we truly understand what faith is and what it is for. Too often, our world and, by consequence, we operate under the myth of scarcity. Fortunately, the kingdom of God does not. We can be rest assured that faith is not a limited commodity. Faith is not a scarce resource we somehow won't be able to find enough of. For the people of God, faith is a way of life, a reality to be lived into. And perhaps it is because of where I stand, so aware of how much I fall short, how difficult it is to juggle all that is required, demanded, but wanting so earnestly and so desperately to be faithful, that I am grateful to hear in Jesus' words affirmation and not rebuke, reminder and not reprimand. You do not need more faith. You must live into the faith that you already have. I hear Jesus saying to the disciples and to us. In her book, An Altar in the World, Barbara Brown Taylor speaks to this understanding of faith. It's a quote that I have shared with you before, but one that I love because it resonates so much with me. She writes, "To make bread or love, to dig in the earth, to feed an animal or cook for a stranger, these activities require no extensive commentary. No lucid theology. All they require is someone willing to bend, reach, chop, stir. Most of these tasks are so full of pleasure that there is no need to complicate things by calling them holy. And yet, these are the same activities that change lives, sometimes all at once, and sometimes more slowly, the way that dripping water changes stone. In a world where faith is often construed as a way of thinking, bodily practices remind the willing that faith is a way of life. The kind of faith that we are to embody is about reorienting ourselves to a new way of life, a new way of living. It is about living more fully into the reality of who we already are and who we are called to be. It is about understanding how simple ordinary, sometimes even mundane tasks are faith-filled responses to God. And then it's about doing them, about living them, about embodying them. Showing up for work and doing a good job. Listening when someone needs to talk. Getting the kids off to school in the morning. Sitting with someone in the cafeteria who looks like they could use a friend. Volunteering at a local homeless shelter. Voting even if the candidates seem to be discouraging. Writing a thank you note to someone who has done a kindness for you. Cooking supper. Praying for a neighbor who is having a hard time. The list could go on. And that's the point. None of these in and of themselves is really that big of a deal. And yet it is just these kinds of acts that occupy so much of our lives. They are acts of faith, each and every one. In just a few minutes, we will embody together yet another act of faith as we gather today around the table. As Pastor Corey mentioned in his children's sermon, today is World Communion Sunday, celebrated each year on the first Sunday of October. A day in the life of the church we intentionally set aside and remember our connection to and our unity with Christians around the world. Unified in this act, we are invited to remember together our calling, to remember the power of God to transform even our simplest acts into those that offer new life. Power of God to transform the simplest of meals into one that offers life to all who partake. Recently, Hamilton and I were watching a documentary on Netflix called Cooked. One of the episodes within this documentary focuses on the element of air and on the making of bread. During the episode, the narrator, Michael Pollan, shares that he was interviewing a food scientist at the University of California, Davis, named Bruce German. And he says, he told me something that I didn't realize, that if I gave you a bag of flour and water, and you had nothing else to live on, you could live on that for a while, but eventually you would die. But if you take that same bag of flour and water and bake it into bread, you can live indefinitely. So what's happening here, he ponders as this documentary begins, to that flour that we're turning something that won't keep us alive into something that can and does keep us alive. As he begins to explore the process of making bread, the science behind it all, the ways that communities and even civilizations are and have been formed around the practice of making bread, I could not help but hear the echo from Scripture. I am the bread of life. The bread of life, Jesus says. As we gather around this table today, on this special day, we are reminded in the simple act of broken bread and juice poured out that we are united with none other than the Most High God through our Savior Jesus Christ. And it is in this communion, in this relationship alone, that we find the faith that we need. As it turns out, it is faith, often no larger than a mustard seed, faith that we already have,
that enables us to live the life to which we have been called as disciples and apostles and the people of God. At the end of the day, our response is only to answer the question, have we done what we ought to have done? For it is in doing so that we find life, and life abundant. Thanks be to God, and amen. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. They will come from east and west and from north and south and sit at table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. This is our Lord's table. Our Savior invites all who trust in him to share in the feast which he has prepared. I invite you all to stand now as you're able and join in singing our communion hymn this morning, hymn number 507, I Come with Joy.
Let us now affirm the things that we believe as the people of God, saying together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to praise you, O Lord, our God, creator and ruler of the universe. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. You set us in this world to love you and to serve you, to live in peace with all that you have made. When we turned from you, you did not turn from us. When we were captives in slavery, you delivered us to freedom and made covenant to be our sovereign God. When we were stubborn and stiff-necked, you spoke to us through prophets who looked for that day when justice shall triumph and peace shall reign over all the earth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with choirs of angels and with all your faithful people of every time and place who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. God of majesty and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You sent him into the world to satisfy the longings of your people for a Savior, to bring freedom to those held captive by sin, and to establish justice for the oppressed. He came among us as one of us, taking the lot of the poor and sharing in human suffering. We rejoice that in his death and rising again, you set before us the sure promise of new life, the certain hope of a heavenly home, where we will sit at table with Christ our host. In remembrance of your mighty acts of mercy in Jesus Christ, we take this bread and this cup, and we celebrate his dying and his rising as we await the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ, a foretaste of Christ's heavenly banquet. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry throughout the world until Christ comes in final victory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. On the night that he was betrayed, our Savior took bread. And after he had given thanks, he broke it, saying, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you. Take it, eat it, and do this in remembrance of me."
The same way, after supper, Jesus also took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. For every time that we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim our Lord's saving death until he comes again." Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. I invite you now to join with me in the prayer of response printed in your bulletin. God of grace, you invite us to your table and welcome us as part of your family. You feed us with your body and satisfy our deepest hunger. We thank you for these gifts. Now send us out into the world by the power of your Spirit, that we may be your witnesses, sharing the life-giving news of the gospel. Amen. Now let us sing our closing hymn of the morning, hymn number 386, Oh for a World. Into the world trusting that the faith that has been given to us as a gift from God, faith even the size of a mustard seed, has the power to do miraculous things. And as you go, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you might abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit now and forever. Amen.